أيها الحبة في الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Right next to me is a young gentleman who I was told by the late marhum Sheikh Fuad Isaacs that this is my friend. And he said to me, always look after him. So today I want to just say, Alhamdulillah, نحبكم في الله. We love him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may his presence with us continue forevermore, inshallah. May Allah bless you, inshallah. Now he can take a wonderful seat. And one of the reasons why I did that is because just to let us know, الدُّنْيَا سَعَى فَجْعَلْهَا طَعَى. This dunya is just 1 hour. Sometimes when you have a near-death experience, you can feel like your whole life is flashing by you, as if in a few moments you see your entire life, really meaning that this dunya is just but 1 hour. فَجْعَلْهَا طَعَى. أَلْحَيَاتُكَ لَمْحِ الْبَصَرِ. Life is like a wink of an eyelid. And the Urdu poet says it very nicely, char din ki zindagi firanderi raat khali hat aaye hai aur khali hat jayenge. That this life that we live is only 4 days, and then you have the darkness of the qabr. We have come with nothing and we will go with nothing. And that's why time, the most important commodity that anyone has is time. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by time, wal asr inna al insana lafi khusr. That surely mankind is a state of constant perpetual loss by virtue of time withering away, except those who believe. Those who believe, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And those who do good deeds. And that's why you see, since time immemorial, even from the time when the Prophet ﷺ is reported allegedly to have said, كُنْتُ نَبِيًّا وَآدَمُ بَيْنَ الْمَاءِ وَالطِّينِ أو كما قال صدقت يا رسول الله الكريم. I was a Nabi even before the sand was put to the water to make the clay to form Adam alayhi salam. And that's why time has witnessed great times, good times. It was great times when our mother and father Sayyidina Adam and Sayyidatina Hawa were in Jannah. It was really good times. And then the first hijrah that took place when they came from Jannah to earth, that was not really very good times for them, leaving the purity and the beauty of Jannah, but coming also to the beauty of the dunya, but being separated. Then when they met on the Mount of Arafah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave them, those were really good times, great times. Even when Sayyidina Nuh and his companions were saved from the floods, those were good times. When Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam was saved from the fire and the fire became cool, those were good times for Sayyidina Ibrahim. When Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam was thrown in the well, but he was not killed and he was saved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those were good times. Even when Sayyidina Musa was, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused for the entire ocean to be split and for him to be saved from Fir'aun and his followers and Fir'aun to be encapsulated in that water, those were miraculous times. When Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, when he came with his mother from the seclusion that his mother took, Sayyidatina Maryam, and she came with the child and she was really concerned about the blasphemy that's going to affect her when her people are going to threaten her. Where did she come with a child without her being married? And then she said, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. And then she turned and she pointed to the baby in the cradle. And they said to her, قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. Are you expecting us to speak to this baby in the cradle after what we have done by bringing shame to the family? And when that baby said, in the first miracle documented for Sayyidina Isa, he said, قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ آتَانِيَ الْكِتَابُ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. He said, indeed, I am the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah made me a Nabi. Those were indeed the great times when this beautiful baby spoke in the cradle. But almost 600 years passed from the coming of Isa alayhi salam, with the beautiful message of love and muhabba, love for the creator, love for the creation, this consistent message and constant message that all the anbiya came with, it seems that that message was withered away. That message was now just a faint memory. And things were really getting very, very bad in the hot, sandy deserts of Arabia. It's as if it came to a time of hopelessness. People used to kill each other for no reason. Not only that, if a camel from one tribe goes and wanders and trespasses onto the land of another tribe, they would fight each other for years. And because of their tribal affiliations, it would not just be one tribe fighting another tribe. All the tribes with their alliances would fight the opposition tribe with their alliances. It was such a time when idols, the symbol of Tawheed in the great times of Sayyidina Ibrahim and Ismail, when they built the Kaaba as a symbol of pure Tawheed, that same Kaaba was now riddled with idols as if they had an idol for each day of the year. Over 300 idols was now filling up the Kaaba and its precincts. It seemed that it was the worst of times. It was a time of hopelessness. And if that was not enough, fathers were specifically choosing their female daughters and burying them alive. It seemed that it was a type of complete hopelessness. It was a type of dhulumat, darkness and dhulumat over dhulumat. And if that was not enough, then Abraha comes with his elephants and he comes to attack and destroy the Kaaba. As if things were not getting any worse, it couldn't get any lower than the lowest ebb of humanity, Abraha comes with his elephants, elephants coming in the hot sandy desert. What do elephants have to do in hot sandy deserts? Because we know that elephants need water. What are they doing in the desert? Because clearly it's out of place. Camels are meant to be in the desert because they have humps to store water. What are elephants doing in the desert? It's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was creating an extraordinary event, because in those times Imam al-Balazuri records that not more than 17 people in the entire Arabian Peninsula, which is over 9 countries today, only 17 people could read and write. So people would never know how to record time. They would not know what is the beginning of good times, what is the ending of bad times, or what is the ending of good times. They would only record events by virtue, or dates by virtue of events. I was born in the year of the floods, or I was born in the year of the great famine, or I was born in the year of the great disease, or I was born in the battle of such and such. So in that way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala documented, so mankind immemorial will know when the best of times started. At a time of darkness and complete dhulumat and a time of hopelessness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the people in the hot sandy deserts of Arabia the hope when Abraha tried to attack the Kaaba. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant to save not only the Kaaba, because the Kaaba was destroyed 2 times after Abraha's incident. In the time of Yazid and Abdullah bin Zubair, the Kaaba was destroyed 2 times before. Allah did not, subhanahu wa ta'ala, did not send tayran ababil. He did not send birds with stones. It's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to protect that which more than the Kaaba itself. Because at that time, in the womb of a beautiful lady called Sayyida Amina radiallahu anha, was in her womb the blessed and the most perfect creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had Abraha been successful, he would have enslaved the woman. He would have got them to abort their fetus. They would have been taken in chains, and the men would have been killed. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to protect that beautiful baby in the womb of Sayyida Amina, none other than Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 4 women were given the glad tidings and the honor to be there at the time of his birth, and their names are Barakah, Ash-Shifa, Fatima, and Thuwayba al-Aslamiyya. These 4 women witnessed the birth of the greatest of creation, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyida Amina says that at the time of the birth, it's as if I saw a light emanating from me that I could see all the way to the palaces of Syria. And this beautiful baby then comes onto this earth, and his name is given Ahmad in the heavens and Muhammad on this dunya by his grandfather Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib. He lives with his grandfather for a few years, with his mother for a few years, and then his grandfather Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib, and then thereafter he lives with Abu Talib, his uncle, until he reaches the age of 25. This great messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the city of Mecca, he started getting known to be Al-Amin As-Sadiq. In his trading and his dealings on behalf of Abu Talib, the entire city got to know that there is such a man by the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he is known for his honesty, his integrity, his trustworthiness, and the ability to speak the truth. And here, the honorable lady Khadija bint Khuwaylid, she hears about him and she says, I would like to enlist him to lead my caravan towards towards Sham. And she then sends Maysara, her trusted employee, to go with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, approach him to lead the caravan. He goes to Sham, and the way he conducts the business, the way he handles the entire affairs of Sayyidah Khadija, she sent Maysara for that specific reason, so he can bring back reports as to how did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conduct himself with the caravan. And when he comes back, the Prophet is quadrupled. She has made a Prophet that she has never made before, but not with deception, with ethics, with proper mu'amalat, with honesty and integrity. And he reports then to Sayyidah Khadija that I find in him such impeccable character. Then we found many miracles on the way. It's as if the sun never shone on him, because there was always a cloud over him. The way he spoke the truth, the way he interacted with the people, I've never seen a man with such integrity and honesty. She immediately seized the opportunity. And as an intelligent woman, a billionaire at that time, a successful businesswoman, she immediately gets her confidant Nafisa to go and take the proposal to Sayyidina Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he brings it to his uncle, and it's presented to him, Abu Talib. And that way the two of them become married. The reason I'm mentioning this, the series of events that took place through the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was born, when he was taken by Halimatu Sa'adiyya, when the miracle took place, when his chest was split open, and you know that miracle that is documented, and throughout his journey, the way he looked after his people, even through times of animosity, when they wanted to fight about the putting of the Hajri Aswad, how he solved that problem by getting the tribes together, and how he developed the name Al-Amin and As-Sadiq. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam then lived his life with Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha, until the point came when we recited these verses tonight in Suratul Muzammil wa Suratul Muddathir. These verses take us to the very atmospheres of the first revelations, when the Prophet ﷺ came back from the cave of Hira and he was shivering, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, Dathiruni, Dathiruni. And she covered the Prophet ﷺ and she said to him, your Lord will never forsaken you. And this is not a delusion or an illusion. She believed in him when no one believed in him. One day the Prophet ﷺ was wondering what is happening, because revelation was not coming. And then Sayyidina Jibreel came, and she wanted to test for him so he can know whether this is authentic or whether there's any illusion. And she immediately then took out her hijab and her hair flowed down, and she came closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she asked him, ya Rasulullah, is Jibreel now there? He said, no, he has left. Then she said, clearly this is truly revelation, because had he stayed, then I would have known it to the shaitan. But because I loosened my hair and came out of hijab, indeed he is not there anymore. That is sufficient proof for me that this is not an illusion or a delusion. One day Sayyidina Jibreel came down alayhi salam, and he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rasulullah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent salams for Khadija, and to tell her that he has a palace for her in Jannah. Look at that relationship. When he used to go up to cave of Hira, she used to accompany him and she used to take food for him. There were times when she spent time in the cave with him, but she would leave him alone. She knows he is meditating and connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but she would not interfere with his prayer and his connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the same Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha that stood by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The reason I'm mentioning these events, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused for that year in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born to be called Amul Fil. So that even though people could not document what date and what time and what month and these type of things at that time, at least they will know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in a year of a great event, the event of the Amul Fil, in which the birds came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and protected the Ka'batul Musharrafah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in receiving his revelation and the hardships that Sayyida Khadija, she stood by him through thick and thin. And she was a billionaire. She used to contribute her money in feeding the slaves, in feeding the Muslims at the time of the boycott. And she stood by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she passed away on the 10th year of the call. And that entire year is called Amul Huzn, the year of grief and sadness, because both Sayyidah Khadija and the uncle Abu Talib of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, both of them passed away. And it was such a difficult situation and condition in the time of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's time, it's important for us to reflect that these verses of the Holy Quran, they were revealed in a context. There is a pretext for this context where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wanting us to delve into also the asbabun nuzul, the reasons of these revelations, so these revelations can become more meaningful to us. And we pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the hidayat and tawfiq by virtue of these events and these narratives that have taken place, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ignites our mind to do more research so that we can understand the meanings of the Quran and we can dive into the atmospheres of the revelation so that it can become more beneficial to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is communicating to us in the first person. He has messages for us in the Holy Quran, and it's up to us, inshallah, to extract these messages and use it practically and implement it in our lives. These are the last few moments. And tonight the mashayikh say that if an odd night and Laylatul Jum'ah coincides and comes together, irrespective of whether it is Laylatul Qadr or not, it is indeed a great event coming together. An odd night and Laylatul Jum'ah. Some say that when these two combined, it indeed has all the essential ingredients for Laylatul Qadr. And in keeping with that in mind, it's important for us to exert ourselves so that we can indeed benefit from the barakah of this night. So inshallah, we will recite two du'as inshallah before we depart, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can bless us. The one is the du'a that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us to read and recite after me. Allahumma innaka afuun kareemun rahimun تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also gave us a beautiful gift. It's called Sayyid al-Istighfar. This beautiful dua, which is called the dua, the chief dua of forgiveness, the master of the du'as of forgiveness. Anyone who recites this du'a in the evening and they don't get to see the next morning, but they read it with meaning and yaqeen in it and full confidence in what the Prophet ﷺ came with, and they don't live to see the next morning, just by virtue of reading this du'a, Allah grants them Jannah. And if they read it in the morning and they don't get to see the evening, but they have full yaqeen in it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants them Jannah. So read this with me, inshallah, and hopefully we can go into the night in a better spiritual state. Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant khalaqtani wa ana abduk wa ana ala ahdika wa wa'dika mastata'at a'udhu bika min sharri ma sana'at abu'u laka bi ni'matika alayhi wa abu'u bi dhanbi فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.